Oh, 어우와 악연한 대보란 자세야 변경을 하셨다 그래요. 착수 얼레이 담미에는 다스당시 요리된 경우가 무감거로지 바처럼 강동강가의 제의경이 약리파 타마함하니 신분입니다. 다스다 남아 옹 비슈 그다야 비슈나 비슈타야 부르네 시바티 벅티 비라자 상의 비슈나니 Namaste Saraswati Devi Guru Mami Pichari Mege Vishesha Shambhavari Pasya Shari Sikari Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sivai Vidhaka Shivasri Gaura Bhakti Vinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare My name is Swami. I don't know how I could present it to all of you. But sometimes it's better to speak for oneself. You have a realistic perspective for the audience.
所以呢，最好实际上有时候就是自己在大家面前，然后自己告诉你自己是个什么样的人。
I'm a practitioner of bhakti yoga.
他说我呢是练习奉爱瑜伽的一个练习者。
And I began practicing bhakti yoga in 1972.
我是从1972年就开始练 bhakti yoga 瑜伽，奉爱瑜伽。
And In 1974, I was accepted as an initiated disciple of His Divine Grace, Isi Bhaktivedanta Swami
Prabhupada.
Who is my spiritual master? And from whom I've learned everything that I know in chanting Hare Krishna.
那么从他那里呢，我学习了如何吟诵、吟唱《Hare Krishna》所该学习的一切。Everything
that I know about my purpose being here.
那么呢，我也了解到我在这个世界里头的那个目的究竟是什么。Which
includes explaining my experiences with all of you today.
那今天呢，我会给大家来谈一谈我的体会。Sharing
with you.
跟大家分享我的体会。
And I first was introduced to the Hare Krishna mantra, as I said, in 1972.
那我首先呢，就是人家介绍我有关这个 Hare Krishna mantra 是在1972年的时候。
And I was a spiritual seeker of sorts at that time.
那个时候呢，实际上我是一个在追寻。
And was very much inclined towards the study of Eastern philosophy.
那个时候呢，对于东方的哲学，我觉得特别有兴趣。I
had left the university in early 1972.
那么我在1972年的初期的时候呢，就离开了大学。
Where I was studying in the United States is to become an electrical engineer.
在那个地方，本来在大学里呢，我是学习在美国大学里头学习怎么能够成为一个工程师。But
after 2 years of study, I felt that it was time for me to take a small break and to find out a little bit more about who I am.
在我学习的过程当中，我就觉得其实我应该更恰当的，对我来说，我应该先找到我究竟是谁。Up
until then, I felt I had been put on a fast track.
在这个之前，我就觉得我是被放在一个就是那个转轮上面。So
just like at the airport, there's the slow line and there's the fast track.
就是在这个 airport, 就是在这个飞机场有这个慢的轨道，快的。
if you want to get through quickly, you go through the fast track. So I had felt that I was put on a fast track. Although I didn't know where my destination, the destination was where I was going.
尽管我根本就不知道我的前面的目的地是什么，但是我却被放在了那个快速通道里。
And somehow the destination which had been chosen for me didn't seem to fit my nature.
那么不知怎的，就是感觉到就是人家给我选择的那个人生目标好像跟我是不太合适的。
And I felt it would be better to spend some time to try to understand who am I.
所以呢，我就想说我应该
So I can make a better plan for the rest of my life.
这样的话呢，我的就是接下来的人生，我可以能够有一个更好的人生的计划。
So I left the university in 1972.
所以我在1972年的时候就离开了那个大学。
And as I said, I was attracted to Eastern philosophy.
那当时呢，我跟大家已经说了，我是对这个东方哲学很吸引了。
I had studied. Independently, many books on Eastern philosophy.
我自己呢就阅读了很多很多的东方哲学的书。
And I came across one book in Eastern philosophy entitled Bhagavad Gita.
那后来呢，我就读到了一本东方的这个哲学的书籍，名字叫做《圣典·薄伽瓦坛》，啊不，《圣典·薄伽梵歌》。
And after systematically reading that Bhagavad Gita every day.
每一天有系统地阅读这本《薄伽梵歌》。
Well, I was working.
那当时我已经在工作。
Because when I left the university, I realized that one of the things that immediately I had to do was find a way to maintain myself.
因为我一离开学校，我就发现了，我首先要做的是应该先找一份什么工作，能够维持我的生活。
I didn't plan that either.
那个我也没有做什么计划。
It became a reality very quickly.
这个呢，后来就变得特别现实了，很快就变得现实了。
Because as a university student in the place where I went, it was not very expensive to go to school back in 1970. It was not very expensive to go to school.
就是在1972年的时候呢，去学校上学不是一件很这个花费昂贵的事情。
I was paying about $500 a semester for my study, university study.
所以呢，我就花$500就可以能够得到这个大学毕业的那个。
People hear that now.
现在的人已经说这怎么可能啊，也太便宜了吧。那我是$50,000。现在可能是$50,000。但是我离开学校，我就很快就变得现实了，因为发现自己必须要就是找工作养活自己。那然后呢，我有一些个手艺，我就当了木匠。
And continuing my own independent studies of Eastern philosophy.
然后呢，自己呢就自己去学习那些个东方的哲学。
And then having read Bhagavad Gita as it is by my spiritual master, I became very much inclined to understanding more.
当我读到了就是我后来成为我灵性导师的那个先生写的那个《薄伽梵歌》原意以后，我就觉得特别的感兴趣。
At which time I was introduced to in a more formal way to the method of chanting Hare Krishna.
然后呢，接下来呢，就是被介绍说怎么能够就是以更正式的方式吟诵吟唱那个 Hare Krishna mantra.
And I moved into an ashram and became a monk in 1970.
然后呢，就是为了更正式的练习，我就到了那个灵修所里头去，然后成为了一个和尚，出家人。
And then I also spent a little time in India.
然后呢，在印度呢也待了一段时间。
And since then, I have been a practitioner of Bhakti Yoga.
那从那以后，我就一直是奉爱瑜伽的一个练习者。
And I began, as I said, chanting Hare Krishna in 1972, and I have now been chanting for almost 47 years.
那么我从1972年开始练习这个吟诵吟唱。 这个 Hare Krishna Mantra 一直到现在还在这么做，已经47年了。
And one of the things I was able to accomplish during that time.
那么在那一段时间里，我能够达到一个成就呢？
Was to convince my mother that chanting Hare Krishna wasn't just a passing phase in my life.
就是能够，她也能够吟诵唱 Hare Krishna，而不是她不要阻止我念 Hare Krishna。
Was to convince my mother that chanting Hare Krishna wasn't just a short passing phase in my life.
就是我呢想，在那过程当中，我的成就就是说服我母亲说，这个吟诵吟唱 Hare Krishna这个练习，并不是我一生当中的一个短暂的事情。
Because she had it fixed in her mind that my son is going to be an electrical engineer.
因为在她的心目当中，她就相信说，她的儿子今后就会能够，就是变成一个电气的工程师。And
chanting Hare Krishna, living the way I was living, seemed a little bit incompatible with her conception of what her son should be.
那么我呢，最后去练习这个吟诵吟唱 Hare Krishna mantra。 我所有的这种生活的模式，跟他想象的我该有的生这个生活模式，好像是有一段距离的。
So in the beginning, she was thinking, "Oh, it's something he'll do and he'll get over it."
然后在一开始的时候，他就想说，这个反正就一时的兴趣，他就这么做。然后过一段时间，他就会不做了。
5 years passed, 10 years passed, 20 years passed, 30 years passed.
然后呢，就5年过去了，10年过去了，20年过去了，30年过去了。And
gradually she began to realize my son is going to live his life chanting Hare Krishna.
然后逐渐逐渐的，她慢慢就认识到说，看来我的这个儿子，他这一生就是在吟诵吟唱 Hare Krishna 这么生活了。And
another shock for her is that I became a celibate monk.
然后呢，对她来说让她震惊的另外一件事情就是，她。
I lived as a celibate monk from
1973 to 1986.
With an option to marry if I chose to.
这个呢是他自己的选择。But
in 1986, I accepted a vow, lifelong vow of celibacy.
就是他实际上就是一直到1986年之前当真守生，他都可以选择他最后是不是要继续当和尚，还是可以去出家。但是后来他就选择了这一辈子他就要当这样的出家人了。And
I continued living that way until the present.
然后呢，他就从那以后就继续以这样的遵守的方式，然后一直到现在都是这样。This
was another bitter pill for my mother to swallow.
这个对他母亲来说也是一个很难吞咽下去的姿势。It
was hard enough when she saw me with the shaved head.
对于那个母亲来说，看到自己的儿子把头给剃了，是挺难过的一件事。But
when she learned that I had taken a lifelong vow of celibacy and would not give her any grandchildren, it was definitely something. Not give her any grandchildren, it was definitely something she didn't expect.
然后呢，最后他看到他这个儿子啊，不仅仅是剃了头，而且还发誓一辈子当独身禁欲的那个出家人，也就是说不能给他带来孙子了，当然他很难过。
Nonetheless, over time, she grew to respect my chosen way of life.
但是后来不管怎么样吧，他就慢慢就尊重他的这个自己选择的这种生活模式。And
in due course of time, she actually became grateful for the way I had embraced these values in my life.
随着这个时间的流失，他的母亲实际上变得越来越能够欣赏他能够选择这样的一种生活方式。Because
she always remembered me as a very wild teenager.
因为他母亲记得他曾经是一个非常狂野的少年。Of
the 1960s culture in America.
在1966年那个时候，美国。And
being a wild teenager of the 60s culture in America, I had been living with some very bad habits.
嗯，就 就是六十年代大家知道，就美国那个时候是西皮士运动，所以他是一个狂野的少年，你就想象一下他的那个生活当时是个什么样。
Over time, she grew to appreciate the fact that I lived the way that I lived.
然后，所以呢，看到他这样一直不断的这样的去生活，他越能够就是欣赏他的这种生活模式的价值。
And gradually, she began to understand that the influence of chanting Hare Krishna had on my life had a very positive effect.
然后呢，他就越来越能够理解，就认识到这个吟诵吟唱Hare Krishna mantra 在他的生命当中所起到的那么积极的作用。
Because one of the most powerful experiences that one can get from chanting Hare Krishna.
因为呢，这个人们透过吟诵吟唱Hare Krishna mantra 能够得到的这个非常有力量的效果，其中之一是。
It's a very powerful way to control the mind.
它是可以帮助我们能够控制自己的心念的强有力的方法。
In the Bhagavad Gita, a book which I had read in 1972.
在这个我1972年就读到的那个《国家梵歌》那本书里面。
It is stated that for one who is not connected with the Supreme, can have neither a controlled mind nor steady intelligence.
就是那本国家梵歌里就说了，一个人如果不能够控制自己的心念的话，他的心是不稳定的，而且他也不可能有智慧生发出来。Without
which there can be no possibility of peace.
那么这样的人实际上在他的生命当中要想得到平静是不可能的事情。And
how can there be any happiness without peace?
一个人如果没有平静，哪来的快乐呢？
This verse in itself had a very powerful impact on me.
这就是《国家梵歌》里头的这一节诗本身就给了我很强的震撼。And
I began to understand that not only in the Bhakti Yoga tradition, but in many other yoga traditions, control of the mind is a very important element in the practice of yoga.
后来在我的练习的过程当中，我就了解到，不仅仅是凤爱瑜伽里头，就是控制心念是非常重要的，在所有其他的瑜伽的练习体系当中，都是非常非常重要的控制自己。Bhagavad
Gita is stated that for one who has controlled his mind, it becomes his best friend.
这个《国家梵歌》里就说了，一个控制了自己心念的人，那个心就会成为自己最好的朋友。
And for one who fails to control his mind, it becomes his worst enemy.
控制不了自己心的人，心就是变成我们最大的敌人。
So control of the mind is a central theme in many yoga traditions.
所以实际上，这个所有的很多的传统的这个瑜伽都要谈如何控制心念。
And therefore, in various yoga traditions, there are also various methods for controlling the mind.
那么在不同的这个传统的瑜伽体系里头，就有不同的方法。
One of the most powerful methods which I was introduced to was the chanting of the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra.
那么在这些个方法里头，其中的一个方法，也就是我被教导给予的那个方法，就是吟诵吟唱 Hare Krishna Mantra.
The word mana means mind, and chayate means to deliver.
那个 man 的意思，这个 mantra 是梵文 ，man 的意思是内心，tra 的意思是使其获得拯救。
So not only is chanting Hare Krishna mantra, but it is a Maha mantra.
那么呢，我们在吟诵吟唱的这个 Hare Krishna mantra 不是一个普通的 mantra， 它是一个 Maha mantra， 是个伟大的 mantra。
Maha means great.
Maha 的意思是伟大。
It is the great chant for the deliverance of the mind.
也就是说，这个是对于让内心获得解脱，是一个非常伟大、非常非凡的一个 mantra。
And therefore, when I first began and was chanting and was introduced to the chanting.
所以呢，刚开始我被教导怎么样的吟诵吟唱这个 mantra 的时候。
I voluntarily accepted a discipline for chanting.
我就开始呢，自觉自愿的，就是接受了想要吟诵吟唱好这个 mantra 应该做到哪些个戒律。
There are different ways to chant it, even the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. One method of chanting is called Kirtan.
一种方式叫 Kirtan.
And it is very popular today, even in many places throughout the world, it's called Kirtan Yoga.
现在在全世界都变得非常的流行, 有一个名字叫做 Kirtan Yoga.
Kirtan yoga means to perform yoga, which is yoga means actually to connect. And kirtan means that everyone does it together. When everyone does it together, it's very powerful. In fact, it's even a little bit easier.
事实上是甚至是更容易的。
You get extra support when others are also doing the same.
因为当我们在做的时候，别人也在做同样的事情，我们就会感觉到是得到了一个支持。
Another form of chanting is called japa.
那另外一种吟诵的吟唱的方式叫做japa.
Japa actually means chanting simply for oneself.
那japa的意思就是是自己一个人独自的做。
It's generally done in a quiet place.
一般的情况是找一个安静的地方。And
it's done chanting softly.
然后呢，自己呢非常柔声的在那儿做。And
listening very attentively to the sound vibration.
然后仔细的聆听自己发出来的那个声音震荡。I
began chanting japa in 1972, minimum of 2 hours daily.
我从1972年就开始吟诵这个mantra，也就是japa。
And have continued for 47 years.
然后呢，我做了47年，连续不断的。
Although sometimes my experience has been that I've chanted much longer than just 2 hours.
然后尽管呢，有的时候我的感受是我念的比那个两个小时还要长。
There were some days that I would sit and chant sometimes for 10, 12 hours.
有的时候我甚至一天可以坐在那儿，就是连续的这样吟诵10到12个小时。
And someone may think, how is it possible to be able to do that?
那有些人就会想着，这怎么可能呢？一个人就是这么长时间的做这件事。
And it's because it is a very powerful method of controlling the mind.
那是因为这个方法是一个强有力的控制我们心念的方法。
Because the mind is very, very restless and is always looking for objects to strike.
因为我们的心念是非常的不稳定的，总是有什么就可以把我们的心念给牵扯过去。
And therefore that is why in Bhagavad Gita states that if one controls the mind, it can become the best friend.
这就是为什么在国家梵歌里说了，一个人如果能够控制自己的心念，我们的内心就会成为我们最好的。
But it becomes the enemy if it's not controlled.
但是呢，如果我们不去控制自己的心的话，内心就会成为我们最大的敌人。
Why does it become the enemy?
为什么会变成我们最大的敌人呢？
It becomes the enemy because it's very difficult to understand ourselves as long as we're always dictated by the swaying of the mind.
是因为当我们的内心总是被各种各样的事物牵着跑的时候， 一个人是很难了解自己是怎么回事的。
It is described that the self is eternal.
经典里描述说，自我它是永恒的。
It is a spiritual spark.
它是灵性的火花。
But in its present condition state, it is covered by material elements.
但是呢，现在我们的状态是什么呢？ 我们这个永恒的灵性的火花被物质
There are the gross physical elements such as earth, water, fire, air, and ether.
有土、水、火、气、空间这些粗糙的元素。
And there are the more subtle elements which are described as the mind, intelligence, and false ego.
然后呢，还被精微的物质元素，也就是心、智、假我这些个元素也覆盖住了。
The eternal cell actually is temporarily identifying with these gross gross and subtle elements. And by identification with these gross and subtle elements, it is very difficult to understand who am I.
当一个人跟这几个粗糙的或者是精微的元素认同，认为自己就是那个的时候，他是很难了解真正的自我是什么的。
And the reason why the uncontrolled mind becomes our enemy.
没有受到控制的心念内心之所以成为我们的敌人。
Because the mind is always looking for objects to strive to gratify the senses of this body.
因为那个内心总是他的想要受到外界的很多东西的吸引，然后呢就希望能够拿来，就让自己进行感官享乐。
But the difficulty is that our contact with both the mind and the senses and this body is temporary.
但是呢，问题是什么呢？就是我们的这些个内心啊，我们的这些个感官啊，等等，这些其实都是短暂的存在。
And because it's temporary, the gratification one gets by satisfying the mind and the senses is also temporary.
所以呢，这些个短暂的存在，然后我们就想要抓住这些，然后让自己感到就是进行享乐，然后让内心满足，这样的状态全部都是短暂的状态。
Therefore, the mind has a tendency to go from one object to the next, to the next, to the next.
由于它是短暂的，不是持久的满足，所以我们的内心就会从一个对象跳到另外一个对象，跳到另外一个对象。
It's described that one of the primary functions of the mind is to go through a vacillating process of what is called boga.
Tiaga，就是说，经典里就描述说，我们的那个内心始终在进行翻转变化。That's two sides of the boga. Boga. Tiaga. 然后呢，总是在boga和tiaga这两个状态当中就翻转变化。Boga
means gratification.
那 group boga 的意思就是感官享乐。And
tiaga means renunciation.
那 tiaga 的意思就是弃绝。Boga
tiaga means that we look for something to satisfy ourselves to enjoy in sensual enjoyment.
这个它的这个意思就是说，我们总是在追寻着一些什么东西，能够让我们进行感官享乐，然后内心感到满足。
But it doesn't really fully satisfy the self.
但是最终呢，它这些东西是满足不了真实的自我的。
And therefore we give it up and look for something better.
然后接下来内心就说，OK，不要了，然后我要去找另外一个。
People do that all the time. It's just like even in modern society, people always look for the best gadgets, electronic device.
就像那个现代社会里头的人们，一天到晚的对那些个电器，有些什么新的电器出来，马上就要去得到。
And they think this is great.
然后就觉得哇，这些东西好了不起哦。
And then the same company that produces the electronic device says, "Oh, we got something better."
然后呢，这个电器的生产公司呢，就总是弄个新的东西，哦，又有一个新的出来了，来吊着我们。
So immediately when we hear all this something better, we think, "Oh, I don't know."
然后呢，我们只要一听说哇，现在他们又出了什么一个新的产品更好，马上那个旧的我们就不想要。
Mind is already thinking there's something better. When am I going to get rid of this device and get the better one?
然后我们的内心就想说，哦，还有一个更好的东西，我怎么能够得到那更好的东西？我怎么把我这个旧的东西把它赶快给扔掉？
This is called boga tiaga.
所以呢，这个叫做 boga， 这个叫 tiaga.
Generally, we renounce because we anticipate that there's something better.
一般的情况下，之所以我们想要放弃什么，是因为我们总感觉有更好的东西。
And the reason why we anticipate there's something better is because whatever we temporarily accepted doesn't fully satisfy us.
之所以我们感觉到那种是特别短暂的，然后会不会有更好的东西，是因为我们得到的东西，每一次得到的东西都不能够真正的完全的满足我们。
If it fully satisfied us, then why would we even think about getting something better?
那有如果有什么东西我们得到的是让我们完全心满意足的话，我们为什么要去想再去得到一个什么更好？This
is in itself an indication that it doesn't fully satisfy.
这个事实本身就告诉我们说，我们追求的很多很多的东西，实际上都不能够真正的满足。
This is simply this one example. There are many examples of Boga Tiaga. Which means accepting something in a positive way with a spirit of enjoyment and then realizing after some time that I need something better.
意思就是说，我们好像很积极的想要得到一些个什么东西， 然后呢，得到了以后，过一段时间以后就想，哎呀，我应该得到什么更好的东西， 然后把那个丢了。
In Western culture, this has become very, very prominent. Also, even when one accepts a spouse, is a wife or a husband.
I
accepted someone as my wife or husband, but I'm not satisfied. I need something.
然后我先就是接受了某一个人成为自己的妻子或者是丈夫，过一段时间，哎呦，不满足了，哎呦，离婚了，再找另外的。
In many respects, this Boga Tiaga is the nature of the mind and it's how it works when the mind is not peaceful.
所以呢，在生活的方方面面里头都是这个样子。当一个人的内心不平静的时候，他一直都会是不断的寻找什么新的能让他满足的东西。So
the goal of any yoga system is to learn how to control the mind so that the mind can become peaceful.
所以呢，所有的传统的瑜伽其实都是在教人如何控制自己的心念，让自己的内心能够平静下来。
To become self-satisfied.
让内在感到自我感到满足。
Self-satisfied means that one becomes satisfied within.
这个自我满足的意思就是说，一个人从内在自己感到了满足。
And becomes less dependent upon looking for external objects of gratification for satisfaction.
而不是老是到外面去寻找那些个身外之物，来让自己好像获得一种满足感。
Such is the power of the Maha Mantra.
那这样的就是有力量的，就是刚才介绍的那个伟大的Mantra，Maha Mantra.
Thank you. The Maha Mantra is a method for learning how to control the mind.
那Maha Mantra就是那个方法，让我们来学习如何控制自己的内心。
Not simply by withdrawing it from the objects of pleasure.
不仅仅是就是拒绝这些个外在的一切。
Not simply by withdrawing the mind from the objects of
不仅仅是把自己的内心从外界的各种感官的对象上收回来。
Which is the method which is adopted by some processes of yoga.
因为有的瑜伽体系就是这么告诉我们的，让我们开始把这个感官的注意力从外界收回来。
There are some processes of yoga which teach mind restraint.
那有一些个瑜伽的，就是告诉我们怎么样的来，就是约束我们的这个心念。
When the mind starts wandering, they bring it back. Yeah.
也就是每一次当我们的这个心又受到什么外界的吸引的时候，我们就把它拉回来。
When the mind is filled with disturbing thoughts, there's an attempt to release those disturbing thoughts.
然后呢，当内心因为什么事情感到备受打扰的时候，然后学习怎么能够把它释放掉。
There are various methods also being taught today in modern society.
现在的这个现代社会里头也在教各种各样如何控制心的方法。
To help people find release and relief from stress and anxiety.
也就是帮助人怎么能够从这种沮丧啊什么痛苦的内心的状态当中能够解脱出来。
Teaching various therapeutic methods for making the mind more peaceful.
所以现在有那么多的调心的方法，都是让内心怎么变得更加平静。
By making the mind quiet.
让那个内心就安静下来。
So that one can look more deeper within.
这样的话，让一个人可以更加深入的看看自己的内在。
This is also being promoted as a type of meditation.
这个现在也被宣传为是某一种的这种冥想方法。
And one of the objects of these various types of meditation is to obtain a peaceful mind.
就是这种就是调心的这种方法，就是让自己的心怎么能够是一种平静的状态。
But one of the difficulties in these types of meditation.
但是有一个问题是，这样的一些个冥想的方法。
Is that we find some time in the day to meditate and to make our minds a little peaceful.
啊，我们会发现，当我们用这些方法。来调心的时候，哎，内心是有一点点平静了。
And those times are definitely a time for relief from the stress of life.
啊，有的时候呢是 OK， 确实是让自己感觉到从那种生活的压力当中就内心摆脱出来。
But then the reality is we have to deal every day with so many stressful situations.
但是现实生活是什么呢？我们每一天都要面对很多很多令人沮丧的情况。
Although it's nice to be peaceful for a couple of hours, when I'm finished with my meditation, I have to go back to the real world.
尽管我就是练习几个小时，然后控制自己的心，让自己的心变得平静下来了，但是我还得站起来到外面去面对现实的社会。
And although those 2 hours of peace were relieving.
尽管呢，我在练习的时候有2个小时，我的内心感觉到哦，释放了，放松了。
The other 22 hours is still very stressful.
但是另外的22个小时还是令人很烦的。
And then we begin living a life of duality.
所以呢，这样的话，就让我们的生活在这种两种状态当中。
How do I pull that?Peaceful 2 hours in my life that I achieved by releasing myself from all of these unwanted thoughts into the mainstream of my life.
我怎么能够把这个2个小时让我能够心静下来的这种状态，就能够变得就是我的整个这个时间都是这个样子呢？
And apply it to all aspects of my life.
然后呢，把有什么方法是让我可以用在我的生活的方方面面，然后让自己始终保持这种好的状态。
So that life becomes a very wholesome way to live.
这样的话，让我们的这种生命是一种特别稳定的一种生活状态。
And not a very divided way to live.
而不是一种分裂的这种生活状态。
This is a dilemma for many people in modern society.
这个是现代的人们都在面对的问题。
And that although there are some opportunities for quiet, peace, rest, relief from distress.
尽管呢，就是有很多的机会让我们可以就是有一种平静啊、安静啊等等的那个状态。
The nature of modern lifestyle is very stressful.
但是呢，其实我们现在看到现代的生活。是非常非常就是让人就是压力特别大的。
And the application of such methods of meditation, do not fully satisfy the needs of the self.
所以有的就是介绍的有的那种冥想的方法，他们并不能够让我们感到完全的满足。
This is called duality.
这个就是二元性相对性。
It's the nature of this world is duality.
因为整个这个世界的本质就是相对性的本质。
Good and bad, happiness, distress, honor, dishonor.
好坏、苦乐、荣誉、羞辱这些。
Good and bad, happiness, distress, honor, dishonor. In Bhagavad Gita, it is said, for one who conquers the mind.
那《薄伽梵歌》里就说了，当一个人能够控制住自己的心的时候。
The super self is reached.
那个就能够得到了，达到了那个超灵，得到超灵了。
And thus he attains tranquility.
这个时候他就完全平静下来了。
For such a person, heat and cold, happiness, distress, honor and dishonor are all the same.
对这样的人来说，冷热、苦乐、荣辱，都是他能够平等的看待和对待。
This is again another result of conquering the mind.
所以这个呢，就是控制住内心以后有的一个效果。
That one learns how to transcend the dualities of this world.
当人能够超越这个世界的相对性的时候。
In The Srimad Bhagavatam, there is one example that helps us to understand the nature of duality. It's by using an analogy of dream. I'm assuming here everybody has some experience with dreams. Analogies are usually useful if they bring into our experience something that we can experience in our life. Therefore, the analogy of dreams is a very helpful way to help us understand
duality.
And then the example is given that although the duality of this world does not ultimately exist, the embodied soul experiences it as real due to his conditioned intelligence.
那个住在身体里头的那个灵魂，之所以他感觉到这些个相对性都是特别真实的，是因为他的那个感官的感觉。
This imaginary experience of a world that is separate from Krishna.
那么这种就是这种幻象的这个世界，我们去体验。 为什么体验是因为跟至尊绝对真理Krishna是因为分开了
can be compared to dreaming and desire.
Dreaming
and
desire.
Desire.
这个就可以被比喻为是做梦还有就是欲望愿望。
When a conditioned soul dreams of something very wonderful or something very horrible.
就像在梦里头那个人梦到特别 令人喜悦的事情，梦到特别可怕的事情。
Or when he daydreams of something he would like to have, or something he would like to avoid.
就像是在白天的时候，有的东西是他特别想要的，有的东西是他想要避免的。
He creates a reality that has no existence beyond his imagination.
所以呢，他自己就在梦里头。 制造的这些个梦境，实际上在现实生活当中是不存在的。Now
I will explain.
现在我要解释。
How many here have had a good dream before?
在座的各位有多少人做过美梦啊？ 美梦。
Yes.
不少。
So most of you, very good.
很好，很多人都做过。This
analogy will work.
所以呢，大家都做过梦，这个比喻就是起作用。
So, whatever it may be, why, or for whatever reason you consider it to be good.
反正就是你做的那个梦，就不管是什么原因，你认为它是一个很好的梦。
You may consider it maybe it's good because you finally got the fulfillment of a long cherished desire in your dream.
你觉得好，有可能那个原因是因为终于我的就是一直想要得到的东西在梦里头实现了。
How many have ever had a bad dream before?
那我们在座各位有多少做过噩梦呢？
Most of you.
绝大部分。
Very good, and this analogy will work even better.
这个非常好，因为这经典里举的例子，那就更起作用了。
Because most of you experience good dreams and bad dreams.
因为你们大家都体验过美梦，也体验过噩梦。
So when you have a good dream.
当你有做美梦的时候。
And you feel really good in your dream.
你在梦里头觉得太好了。But
then all of a sudden you wake up.
然后突然就醒过来了。And
then you feel sad.
然后你就会感觉到特别的悲伤沮丧。为什么你会有这种悲伤的感觉呢？Because
it was only a dream.
因为那只不过是一个梦而已。We
would have been a lot happier if it was real, but we sad because we realized it was only a dream.
如果现实像梦境一样，那多好啊！我们就会更高兴的。但是，它只不过是一个梦而已。But
when you have a bad dream,
但是一个人如果做噩梦的话。And
most of you raised your hand, you've had bad dreams.
绝大多数人都已经举手了，都做过噩梦。
So when you wake up from a bad dream, you feel happy.
当你从那个噩梦里头醒过来的时候，你会感到很开心。啊、
oh, ，It was only a dream.
啊，还有，还有，这幸亏这只是个梦而已。
I'm very happy. 啊、oh, ，It was happy that we woke up.
啊，我们就会特别高兴自己终于醒过来。
I oftentimes tell people that I have this experience. I have this experience.
他自己呢就有过这样的体会。
I have to travel a lot. I'm always traveling.
他呢是一直在全世界在旅游，他一直都在旅行。
And therefore, I'm oftentimes in planes.
所以呢，就经常是在飞机上。
And sometimes I'll fall asleep in a plane.
有的时候他在坐飞机的时候就睡着了。
And somehow I have this experience in my dream that the plane is.Falling very fast.
好，那有时候呢，他会做梦，就是那个飞机就很快速的在下坠。
I wake up.
然后他就醒过来了。
See, nobody else seems to be disturbed.
看看周围，好像没有人有受到打扰的样子。
Feel happy.
那个时候他就觉得挺高兴。
It's only a dream.
因为那只不过是一个梦。
So, with whatever happiness we experience from waking up from a bad dream.
所以呢。就每一次当我们做噩梦醒过来，然后我们感到开心，它是一个噩梦的时候。
Whatever distress we experience from waking up from a good dream.
或者是每当我们做完好，就是美梦，然后醒过来，意识到，哎呀，很遗憾，这只不过是一场梦而已。
It has no connection with reality.
所有这一切跟现实生活有什么关系吗？
It's only connected to a dream.
它只不过是跟梦有关系而已。
But yet the happiness and distress seems very real.
但是我们体验到的快乐和痛苦好像是挺真实的。
But it's only connected to a dream.
但是这一切都是只跟梦有关系而已。
So these are night dreams.
所以这些呢就是晚上做梦的一个情况。
But then there are daydreams.
但是我们也有做白日梦的时候。
We daydream of something we would like to have or something we would like to avoid.
所以呢，我们在做白日梦的时候，我们也有什么是我们想要的，有什么是我们想要避免的。
And when we daydream of something we would like to have, we become very happy in anticipation of the fulfillment of that object.
在我们做白日梦的时候，我们得到了我们想要的那些东西的时候，我们就觉得特别特别的开心。
But because the nature of the mind is boga tiaga.
但是呢，我们的内心的状态，刚才谈过的是 boga tiaga, 就一会要得到什么，一会要放弃什么。
When we actually get the fulfillment of our daydreams,
当我们的白日梦被实现了的时候
，it doesn't fully satisfy the self.
它那个没有让内在的真我感到满足。
And then.We become sad.
然后我们就觉得特别的难过。
We daydream of something we would like to have or something we would like to avoid.
在这个白日梦里头，我们想要得到什么？我们想要避开什么
？So just as the happiness and distress that we experience in connection with a night dream.
这个就像是我们做晚上的，在晚上做梦一样，想要得到什么，想要避免什么。
Has no connection with reality.
实际上跟现实真实是没有关系的。
The happiness and distress that's connected to the daydream also has no connection to reality.
晚上做的梦跟现实生活，不管是苦还是乐，实际上是没关系的。那么其实经典里说，在白天我们的所有这一切做梦的这种状态，也是跟真实是没关系的。
The reality is that.I'm only temporarily connected to this mind, to the senses, and to this body.
真实的真相是什么？是我们短暂的跟自己的内心、跟感官、这个感官以及感官对象短暂的有一个接触。
But I have an existence beyond this temporary mind, senses.
但是实际上，真我的存在，它是超越心智、什么感官、身体的。
And the chanting of Hare Krishna mantra is actually what brings us more in touch with myself.
而吟诵吟唱 Hare Krishna 这个练习方法是让我们跟真正的我开始能够有一个接触。
It is a transcendental sound vibration.
它是超然的声音震荡。
And because it is a transcendental sound vibration, instead of just trying to empty the mind from all disturbing thoughts.
所以呢，这种超然的声音震荡，比我们只是想要静心啊、放空啊这种方法。
One gets help in controlling the mind.
相比较的话，那么这种方法，吟诵吟唱 Hare Krishna， 它是帮助我们控制我们的。
Because by meditating on the transcendental sound vibration.
因为我们透过冥想这个超然的声音震荡。
Mantra, the mind is delivered.
啊 ，mantra 就是我们的内心就解放了。
The mind is elevated from accepting and rejecting.
然后我们的内心从那个一直不断的在想要得到，还要放弃这个来来回回的摇摆当中，我们就超越了。
It is brought into a more elevated platform.
让我们整个是处在更高的层次上。Which
is to come in touch with the self.
而这种更高的层次，它是跟真我开始有一个接触。Just
as the body needs gratification.
就像这个躯体，它是需要感官享乐。The
self needs gratification.
其实真我它也需要真正的享乐。But
what gratifies the body doesn't gratify the self.
啊，我们让这个身体去享乐，但是这样的享乐不能够让真我。
My spiritual master used to use a simple analogy.
我的灵性导师曾经用了一个非常简单的例子。
Of a golden birdcage.
就像一个金子制的鸟笼子一样。
That if you have a very nice golden birdcage.
如果我们就是给一只鸟一个特别精致的那个鸟笼子，金子做的。
And the first thing you do every morning when you wake up is to polish your birdcage.
然后每一天早上一起来，第一件事就是怎么擦洗那个精致的鸟笼。
It's a very valuable cage.
因为这个鸟笼太值钱了。
And you want to keep it nice and polished.
你就想要一直不断地把它擦得闪闪发光。
But if you polish the birdcage every day.
但是如果我们每天只是擦亮那个鸟笼。
But neglect the needs of the bird.
但是却不管。 那个鸟笼里头那只鸟，它的需求。You
have a very attractive cage.
因为那个鸟笼是很吸引力的。But
in due course of time, you'll have a dead bird.
但是，如果一天到晚不喂里头的鸟的话，过一段时间，鸟就死在里头。
In the same way, the self needs satisfaction.
同样的道理，真正的自我，它需要得到满足。And
the transcendental sound vibration is what brings us more in touch with the self.
而这种超然的声音震荡，是能够让我们真我能够触碰到真我，让真我得到满足。So
that the very vital question which most people should ask, who am I?
所以呢，这个人们最要问的问题应该是我是谁。
Can be answered by understanding who I am.
人可以透过
Not only am I not this temporary physical body, mind, and senses.
到最后我们就能够明白，其实我们不是这个短暂的身体，也不是感官，也不是那个心。
But I have an eternal state of existence.
我们就会了解到，原来真正的自我，它是一个永恒的存在。
Which is beyond the temporary physical elements of this world.
它是超越这个物质世界里面的各种各样的那种物质的元素。
And when the self experiences the satisfaction.
当真我，真正的自我，真正体会到了那个满足。
What are the symptoms of experiencing this self-satisfaction?
那么一个人他的真我感到满足的那个表现是什么呢？
His mind becomes controlled and peaceful.
就是他的内心完全是一种被 控制住了的状态，是特别平静的状态。
Because we begin to see the objects of this world from a completely different perspective.
然后我们再看整个这个世界里的一切，我们是从另外一个维度，一个角度去看。
If the mind is not peaceful, we'll look for any object we can possibly find to satisfy it.
如果我们的内心是不平静的话，我们就会以为我们所看到的一切是不是能够满足我们。
and go through this boga, tiaga, but if the mind is peaceful, one begins to see this world for what it actually is. This world is temporary.
我们就会看到这个世界，整个这个世界实际上是一个非常短暂的世界。
I have an existence beyond this world.
但是呢，我的那个生命的存在实际上是超越这个短暂的世界。
It's just like taking a fish out of water and putting it on land.
这个就像是把鱼从水里头捞出来，把它放到岸上一样。
You take a fish out of water and put it on the land.
如果我们把鱼从水里捞出来，给它放到岸上的话，
you could try to give the fish so many different things for his comfort and pleasure.
你可以给这条鱼各种各样的东西，试图让它感觉到舒服，感到高兴。
Give him a drink.
你可以给它喝的饮料。
Give him a television to watch.
你可以给它一个电视让它看。
Let him listen to some music.
让它去听听什么音乐。
The fish doesn't want any of those things.
但是那个鱼它不会要这些东西。
Fish wants to be back in the water.
鱼唯一要的就是能回到水里去。 It's
the natural place for the fish to live.
因为水是鱼本身正常生活的一个环境。
In the same way, the eternal soul is like a fish out of the water in this temporary.
那同样的道理，我们那个永恒的真我，实际上现在住在这个地方，就像是从鱼里出，不是。
And when the self experiences some satisfaction,
那个当那个真我真的感受到一些个满足的时候，
then we begin to see this world.
然后我们那个时候，我们就会从另外一个角度看这个世界了。
That's what my mother couldn't figure out.
这就是为什么我妈当时就完全没办法明白我在干嘛。
She couldn't understand in the very beginning what was going on with her son.
她从一开始就不能够明白她那个儿子到底发生什么事儿了。
I was living much different. I had much different values in my life than I did as a teenager.
也就是他后来的整个的人生的价值观，跟他曾经是个少年的时候的那个价值观完全就不一样。他是更有价值的。
In fact, I'll tell you something very honestly.
我要告诉大家，我要特别诚实的告诉。I haven't repeated
this so much, but because I told you a little bit about my past, I'm going to tell you.
我跟其他人没有说过很多，但今天因为我跟你讲了我的过去了，所以我跟你谈一谈。
My mother knew how I lived as a teenager.
我妈可是知道我在少年的时候是怎么生活的。
She didn't like that.
她当然很不喜欢我的那种生活。那个时候完全是一个狂野的少年。
60s, that's in America, you have to understand.
你们要了解60年代，60年代的美国是个什么样子。
Just think of the 60s in America, and then the whole question is answered.
好，只要我们想到60年代的美国是个什么时代。
And when my mother found out that I had become a celibate monk,
当我妈发现我变成一个真守生的时候，
And she actually came to the ashram where I was living.
她实际上去了我住的那个灵修所。
And she appealed to me.
然后她请求我，
Please. Go back to drugs and sex.
请你能不能回去继续的吸毒，然后乱性。
She actually appealed.
她实际上当时是在祈求她能够回去重新过吸毒和乱性的生活。
Although she was repulsed by it when I was a teenager.
尽管她那个时候她在那么做的时候，她母亲是很不喜欢。
If she was coming and appealing to me, please go back to that. Don't do that.
但是现在他却跑到那个灵修所里去，跟他的儿子请求说：“你能不能回去过原来的那个吸毒和乱性的生活？你别这么样的生活，好不好？”
She couldn't understand.
他简直没法明白。
That is something higher.
他不明白有什么更高级的东西。
It might be difficult to understand.
那个更高级的东西，也许我们不是很好理解。
But how many songs do you know that you can go on singing for 47 years?
但是你想象一下，比方说你这一辈子，有哪一首歌是你能够47年一直不断唱，而且不厌？
And you don't You're always singing the same song.
只是那一首哦。
Can you do that with any of the modern songs you're singing?
你现在的这些流行歌曲，你有没有过很长时间一直不断就唱一首？
Can you stay singing the song for 47 years?
你有没有可能说唱一首歌47年一直不断唱？
And it always gets better.
而且呢，还越唱越甜美。
It doesn't lose its taste.
不会觉得越来越没味道。
That's spiritual.
这个就是灵性的、超然的。It
gives satisfaction to the self.
这个是给自我以满足的。But
it's a mystery to those who try to taste it by licking the outside of the bottle.
但是呢，有一些个人如果他永远都不去自己去亲自品尝，而总是用舌头去舔那个瓶子的外面的。
If you want to taste very sweet honey,
一个人如果说想要去品尝那个甜美的，
you can taste it by looking outside the bottle.
你不可能是仅仅是舔那个瓶子外面，你就能够品尝到那个甜美的感觉。
You have to take the lid off and go inside and taste yourself.
你必须是把里面的那个内容去品尝。
So in the same way, we are presenting this chanting of Hare Krishna.
所以同样的道理，我们现在就在给大家介绍这个吟诵吟唱 Hare Krishna 的这个方法。
As a method of coming in touch with the self.
这个方法是能够直接跟真我能够接触的。
And when one comes in touch with the self,
当一个人开始跟他的真我接触了，
then he carries that identity into everything he does in his life. He carries that same identity into everything that he does in his life.
那他呢就会是，就是他这一生所做的所有的一切。
If one comes in touch with the self, then he carries that identity into every aspect of his life.
Okay, 一个人如果他跟自己的真我 发生了接触的话，那么接下来他的整个的生命的各个方方面面，他就会一直都是以这样跟真我接触的状态进行了。It's
not just a 1 hour or 2 hour experience in the morning.
这个就不是说早晨起来有1个小时或者2个小时的这种体验。It's
an experience that one has at work.
这种体验跟真我接触体验，就是甚至在工作的时候会有这种体验。With
family,
跟家人在一起的时候有这样的体验。With
everything else that one does in life,
也就是他在一生当中无论做什么，他都会有这样的。It's
a much more wholesome way to live.
这个是一种更能够让人能够稳如泰山的一种生活。
Which is to learn how to live in this world by knowing who I am and what my purpose is meant to accomplish in this world.
也就是说，一个人他能够明白自己我在这个世界里我究竟是谁，然后我这一生我究竟应该取得什么样的成就，他都明白了。
I am a temporary resident of this world.
就会明白说，其实我是这个世界的一个短暂的过客。
And myself, my identity is beyond this temporary world.
我的那个自己，我的真我。 我的身份实际上是超越这个短暂的世界。And
by coming in touch with the self by chanting the Hare Krishna mantra,
那透过这个吟诵吟唱 Hare Krishna mantra 跟真我发生实质性的接触，One
can directly experience peace.
人就可以直接的感受到平静。He
becomes peace with himself and peace with everything around him.
他就是不仅自己的内在变得特别的平静，那所有的跟他有接触的一切，他都可以和平共处。And
then the constant allurements and temptations of this world can be seen for what they actually are.
然后呢，他就可以看到，就是所有的原来的，就是眼前的，接触到所有的一切，他们的实际的本质究竟是什么。
One learns how to live in this world, accepting the necessities of life in this world.
人就活在这个世界上，他就接受他需要的一切。
Because they're required to maintain body and soul together.
因为我们需要就是灵魂和身体能够保持一致，然后正常的活着。
Instead of being dragged one thing to the next,
他就不 不会一天到晚的被外界的所有的一切拉的东跑西西跑的。
Due to the uncontrolled mind.
啊，其实这种状态都是因为内心不受控制而造成的。
So this is simply a little elementary presentation of the benefits of chanting Hare Krishna.
所以呢，这个就是我现在刚才讲的这些，就是对于这个吟诵、吟唱 Hare Krishna 对我们有什么真实的好处的一个短暂的介绍。
There are many more details.
还有很多很多的细节性的知识。
But if one simply grasps even a little elementary presentation of the benefits of chanting Hare Krishna.
但是呢，如果人们对于就是我们介绍的吟诵、吟唱 Hare Krishna 的好处的那个部分接受的话
，then they can achieve immediate benefit.
他可以马上就得到那个吟诵、吟唱的利益了。
Just as the person who takes the lid off the cover of the bottle of honey and puts his finger in to taste it, immediately find out if it tastes sweet.
这就像一个人他打开那个蜂蜜瓶的瓶盖，用自己的手指蘸一些蜂蜜，然后直接去。去舔，他就马上能够知道那个蜂蜜的甜美。
So we invite you to chant Hare Krishna.
所以呢，我们邀请大家跟我们一起。
We'll be chanting a little bit more of Hare Krishna.
好，我们呢就再唱一段，好吧？
好。
好。
OK。
too.